Welcome everybody back to the coverage of the Join Dota Masters. I say welcome back because it's been a while since we've done one of the Masters, but we are here back again for the number 13. That's right, 13th installment of the Join Dota Masters. And if we got some awesome teams available for you right now, the best teams across Europe as well as the US. And we're starting off with Team Liquid, one of the best teams in the US right now, going up against Kaipi. They have a bit of a Canadian spark in them, but they are a European team, and they're a team which is really oppressed across the board. Had a little bit of a rough time with Eternal Envy on holidays recently, and now they are back in full force. Looking forward to see how they go up against Team Liquid. Let's jump ourselves inside the game. It has already begun, and luckily, you know what? We're having a bit of a Canadian influence, a bit of an American kind of influence in this game, so that means I'm going to bring in my co-caster. He's been quirky, he's been fun, he's been knowledgeable, so we say, you know what? We'll bring him back. Clairvoyance Man, welcome back to the broadcast.
Man, I hate how you manage to always insult me somehow in the intro, man. You call me quirky and stuff. Now, you know, I'm a sensitive guy, and, you know, all I can say is, all right, Toby, if that's how it is, then.
There's no harm in quirk. There's no harm in quirk.
Okay.
Everyone loves a good quirk, man. Everyone loves a good quirk.
I see. Mm. Well, interestingly enough, as you have called it out, this is a match that not like a lot of people are watching very closely, but I mean, me, I gotta say, me especially. KP is actually using my TeamSpeak, they're just a couple channels down, and yeah, it'd be actually very funny if I just kick them all and then just see their reaction. Maybe they'll think they get DDoS'd or something, but
no, don't you dare, man. Don't you dare. I don't want to hear anything about that for this entire night.
Envy was actually talking about it before the game. He was asking me, am I gonna get DDoS'd, guys? And I'm like, well, you know, I have the power, so.
Let's move on, man. Let's move on quickly and very, very smoothly and look into our draft, because right now this is going 100% according to plan. So KP, they start off banning off the Wisp and banning off the Nyx. Keeper of the Light as well as a Batrider being banned out here by Team Liquid. Of course, Nyx, like, man, we were casting the other night, and Nyx, he kind of actually, like, filtered through everything. Like, people were starting to ignore him a little bit, but this time it seems like Zizu wants to give him enough of a priority, they ban him in the first two.
Yeah, it kind of seems that right now, how Nyx stands is, it's like an Undying. It's gotten to that point where, yeah, at one point he was kind of just like the end-all, be-all kind of thing, where you pick him and then you have a playstyle and you win with it just because the hero is, like, he excels at what he does. Undying, for example, used to just excel at dominating team fights and going aggressive with the tri-lane. And speaking of the tri-lane, KP2 pick up their Bane, and they're probably going to pick up their plus one. And just before I go off too far on that, like, yeah, Nyx Assassin, it's also similar in a sense that when you pick the hero, I mean, he's very good in many, many roles. But most of the time nowadays, you'll see him on support because on the four position is where he's most efficient at. And there is the Clockwork counter probably for the Lifestealer or maybe a little bit of a block pick even for Bulba. In which case, I'd say Liquid will probably respond. I'll say a Puck is what I'm expecting come out of Liquid this game. If they don't go with the Puck, I feel like they're going to go with the Storm Spirit. But it's certainly an option in the third pick here. So, and yeah, Nyx Assassin kind of dictating the playstyle just by the hero. And I guess some teams, they just want to play with it or they don't want to play with it at all.
And 10 seconds remaining. This third pickup, I don't know how hard this has managed to get over the last couple of weeks. But just that mid ban out that you're talking about, like, if they're going to go for the Puck, and they do go for the Puck, they don't want to risk going into this next set of bans and just losing everything. By the way, guys, I want to quickly say, as you'll notice, like, here on the overlay, there's a lot of information right now, things you can win. So if you look to the top left-hand corner of your screen, you got the XFX card you're capable of winning. So big shout as well to AMD for getting the Masters back up and running again. But make sure you head yourself over to joindota.com, click on the news article and follow the instructions, and you can win yourself either one of the two cards or win yourself 50 copies of Bioshock Infinite. That is available through the article itself and the Join Dota Open, which is your chance to compete. Everybody can sign up for the Join Dota Open. If you compete in the Join Dota Open, signing up is just not enough. You need to actually turn up on the day, check yourself in, and then compete. You also have a chance to win another, 50 Bioshock keys as well. So the team selected will be selected at random inside the Join Dota Open. But yeah, you have a chance to also win by win a full brand new spanking game just by playing in the Join Dota Open. We make it easy, man. We make it easy. Like, we've got free stuff coming out of our ears right now. It's too much to give away. But enjoy it. Enjoy it. Enjoy it while it lasts.
I love free stuff. Excellent.
Free stuff's always good, man. Free stuff's always good. I'm sitting here with gifted mice and keyboards. It's great.
Yeah,
it's nice, man. It's nice. Let's get back to our game, though, which is Dota 2. So we'll have Nature's Prophet as well as Darkseer being banned in here by KP. And so just long lane Bulba. Nature's Prophet Bulba as well as Darkseer Bulba. Everything's being blocked out against him. At the same time, the Animage as well as the Gyro is now being taken out against KP. It's going to be nice to see KP play tonight. Like, they played with Come With Me last night, and today, Eternal Envy returned and is now going to compete with his team. So he takes up that hard carry role. So KP go back into that groove we know they have. They seemed to be a little bit more disrupted yesterday when they played.
Yeah, certainly there were a lot of signs for that. Of course, the G1 League being a factor, as well as all the other mumbo jumbo that's going around, though. I won't get into details because that's not my business. But yeah, more importantly, with Eternal Envy, he was at the New York LAN. It was a very small LAN, but nevertheless, there were a couple individuals, a couple names like Numinous and Eternal Envy. He actually went down there to switch anime figures like a big nerd. So, I mean, I won't talk too much about that yet. But holiday is pretty much the right term. He did come back. He's on a tight schedule. He was telling me how he was very tired. But yeah, they took a very convincing game, candid fashion against the Empire. And yeah, with the Ursa usage there earlier and this Lone Druid ban, I'm actually wondering if he's going to go for the Ursa again. Because Ursa is actually not a bad hero against Lifestealer. And if you have a good start with Ursa, he can snowball very, very strongly. The competitive Ursa is played in a different way, though. And I guess I'll talk more about it if it does get picked up. But for now, it's kind of just a potential thing. There's still options of Shadow Demon plus PL or something of that sort. And because the path is kind of open right now, I'll refrain from that statement.
Yeah, let's wait and see if he comes, man. Let's wait and see. Then we can decode it to all our heart's content. But the Lone Druid is banned out, so Team Liquid, they are really shut down for those long lane options, apart from, like, what else is left that people enjoy taking. I will put Windrunner up on that field, but then again, Windrunner really, like, we've been seeing so little of her over the last, like, months even. I would say
months.
Yeah,
absolutely.
The only place we ever saw her was, like, the solo mid kind of role.
Yeah. It's once again, she is a utility hero. With a decent amount of farm, she does a lot. And, in the long lane, it's kind of just like 3v1 scenario. If you get zoned out to the point where you can't do anything, which Windrunner you will, because, you know, your base stats aren't always the best, then you'll have to resort to the jungle, and which is why Firion, Lone Druid, those kind of heroes are kind of more common and more accepted. But I am curious as well to see what Bulba's going to pick up. I mean, it's not going to be a surprise Timbersaw pick, I know that much. And the other options are what? Yeah, there's something like Weaver in the pool, and he's played Broodmother also before. But I'm not too sure about how they're going to want to play those heroes. I mean, like KP, they have a lot of options right now. They're really lacking a little bit of the push stopping. But I'm sure with a good carry pickup, they can either dominate the mid game with the Magnus roaming around as well as the Clockwork. Or they're probably just looking to farm up whoever the carry may be. Because Eternal Envy, I mean, he likes farming on that one position. So I feel like they are going to go for the poor 4 protect 1 style. I haven't really seen KP do a lot of push strats. And actually, speaking of push strats, I'm not too sure what's stopping Liquid from picking up a Juggernaut, but part of me believes they won't happen because of their players. Liquid's known to kind of just draft around the standard, draft around the safe, and they did have their distinct playstyle, especially in before where they had like a lot of Queen of Pains, a lot of dynamic heroes to walk around the map, and that was their playstyle, snowballing early. Lately, they've been resorting to more of a standard pickup. And as we say that, KP does pick up the Lina, so it's the Bane-Lina combo, and then it'll be a plus one. I would imagine it's a PL.
You'd imagine a PL, even without the support of the Keeper of the Lion. I suppose he's still going to work nicely. And that way, they're actually running 4, or if not 5, different types of nukes. Because you had the Lancer Flies that does the damage, then you got Lina with hers, then you got Bane with the Brain Tap, and then you got Mag with the Shockwave. If they are looking to bring somebody down, they can do it. And what I kind of like most about this is the chain control that comes off here from KP. The Shrike is now going to be out from Team Liquid, so they get their combination as well. Like, they get Telekinesis into Split Earth, so they've got their nice combination, then the Open Wounds as well. Allows Team Liquid also, if they so desire, that they can challenge that bottom lane with those three heroes. And you're right, the PL is going to be the final selection here from KP, so they'll go on the back of him. I'm interested to see where Team Liquid want to throw their lanes against this, or if KP, like, PL, we assume him going safe lane. We assume him in the safe lane. Clockwork for the long.
Guaranteed. Yep, guaranteed. This, it's an Eternal Envy. He's gonna look to do a lot of farming in this game. And yeah, as for Liquid, I'm curious rather about their response as well. But lately, they have been trying this whole aggressive challenging thing. It's been
10 seconds
not working out in their
remaining.
idealistic favor. I'm going to say they're going to just play it
Five
safe.
seconds
And
remaining.
the only real question I have is, once again, they still have the hero for Bulb that's left out, unless TC
Reserve
decides to take a
time.
safe lane solo role and then decides to just send all three of them to the long lane and aggressive Charlene. But once again, it's just not worked out in their recent matches as far as I've been keeping up with anyway. So yeah, once again, I'm very curious, and I see a limited number of options for off lane solo. So I'm really leaning towards something new or something different. Like maybe like the two supports are a little bit more dedicated roaming than instead of just pulling. Something of that sort.
They could always just throw the nades to the long lane as well, because we've been seeing that from some other teams. And if they need to, they could just abandon the bottom lane and throw him in the jungle at the end of it all, or just completely sack the bottom lane from the very, very start and say, well, this isn't going to work. It just depends how they want to try and deal with the PL, because they've actually banned out pretty harshly against themselves. Like, they don't have the mag and power buff up. They
Ten
won't have that.
seconds
Jara's
remaining.
been taken out as well. Do they even try and contest PL in the late portion of the
Five
game, or they just
seconds
say, screw it,
remaining.
let's go mid-game aggression, something like a Night Stalker? Nope, they go with someone which you can't contest at a little bit in the later portion of the game. It is going to be the Luna coming their way. So either, it is Bulba. It is Bulba on the Nakes. So they're going to run him down that bottom lane.
Yeah, I actually got to reiterate my point about this one is that while you're right about the lifestealer thing, the more different thing that a lot of people don't know is actually, I talked to Sam Bulba rather the other day after he had a match with lifestealer in the long lane, just going straight into the jungle. And yes, as we had covered earlier, a lot of these times you just can't deal with the 3v1, so you just start in the jungle. He actually does not like that role, and he does not like the hero's playstyle as well. So I'm not too sure how this is going to fare with it. Because as I see with the Luna pick right now, I'm really
10 seconds
thinking
remaining.
that that was just a draft that they had to make on the spot. Like, you know, they said, okay,
Five
they took these
seconds
heroes.
remaining.
We actually should have prepared better, did not prepare enough. And to be completely honest, I think KP's lineup right now is looking a lot stronger than Liquid. If not,
Prepare for
they can
battle.
be punished more because KP's lineup can go into really, really late game and still manage to pull off more of an easier win with the RP and the Fiend's Grip to fall back on, the carry, as well as Clockwork's Cogs going through BKB. Whereas Liquid, once you get a BKB against Liquid, like, what's the real damage dealer? I mean, it's a lifestealer that's going to start in the jungle, so unless you have a really, really lucky or really, really experienced start, you're not going to have a very fast farm up. And then you have the Luna, who's, yeah, Luna's probably going to farm well again in the safe lane, but is she going to be able to contest a PL late game? And every time I've seen that engagement, I'm not too sure if the Luna really comes out ahead. Of course, she can fight because she has Life Leech, but at the same time, PL does farm significantly faster. And as we say that, there's a five man going down bottom. I'm not sure, but it might be a Liquid aggressive trialing.
Yeah, Pylai Dai just saw him come down, and it will be in a
15
Liquid
seconds.
aggressive tri lane. It'll be Mike as well as Fluff to stay down here. They're already playing down the wards for it. Bulba's got a high amount of consumables. And TC, just judging by the amount of tangos, he's also been pulled a set of those. It looks like he's going to be doing it like solo up in that top lane, expecting some kind of harassment damage to come up from Bone 7. It'll be the Clockwork Goblin up in the lane against him. Then looking towards the middle lane, Liquid Kurok will be taking up the role as the Puck. And he'll be going up against the mid solo, which is Arise, the Magnus for KP. And that was bottom lane. Eternal Envy as the Phantom Lancer for the number one farming position. But Zizu as the Bane. And that leaves our last one. Pylai Dai is down here as the Lina. And the last heroes of Team Liquid, Fluff and Stuff over on the Latrak. But it's IX Mike 88 as the Rubick. And then our final player. Normally he's gone solo on the long lane, but this time around he will have his company, the two supports. And that is going to be the role of the Lifestealer, also known as Nakes, and will be played by Bulba.
Bulba indeed. So this trial lane is going to be actually really interesting. There's a pool. PL already got pulled from the start. He's going to have a really easy time CSing. And once again, in the aggressive trial lane, the safe lane trial lane has the advantage as the tactical pause comes out. As for the mid lane, the Puck, and we see this now, it's like just a general trend. You can expect it every game. Pooling is actually such a good mechanic for the people who use it that you cannot skimp out of it. As a matter of fact, pooling sometimes just decides the matchup straight up. If mid lane is decided by two big factors right now, it's block at level one and pulling. If you do a good block and you get pulled more regen than the opponent, most of the time you'll just win outright because of the advantage that you have from level one. So yeah, I guess I won't go too much into the balance implications with that regard, but simply put, Puck versus Magnus, Puck is generally expected to go a little bit ahead in terms of CS because she can harass from the range. But with the pooling, I would say Puck has a larger margin of advantage and larger margin of error at the same time. As for the top lane, TC needed one more regen, and then he'd be like Scandal from yesterday. You know, you get four pieces of regen, but...
The difference with Scandal yesterday is he had no one harassing him after he had all that regeneration.
Mm-hmm.
That was the difference. Where TC has a Clockwork Goblin up against him, and he picked up an Illusion at the very, very start. So he's already got control over this top lane. And then on the bottom lane too, we've got it happening again. We're getting Bane with first level and Feeble. So even if Nakes wants to come down and try and attempt the last hit, I'm actually impressed the Bowler's managed to get 1-for-1 already. Now 2-for-1 because they've given him a little bit more space. But this Enfeebles can make life so hard when Liquid want to initiate in. And looks like Korok, man, is he even get first blood right now? If he gets this orb right, he might even jaunt this down. He got the orb right, he's going to follow it in. First blood for Korok in the middle lane. Did the prep harassment and Magnus arise. Tries to secure himself away to safety, but Korok too good.
Korok too good indeed. He does pick up the very, very, very quick first blood. Once again, so, okay, that one was not a result of pooling, but so a little bit of an unexpected occurrence of events. However, very nice for him. Got his bottle up now and maintaining a giant advantage.
Oh my, way too much damage being done to him. And even then, Pylite die brought in. He needs to actually attack Mike probably once more. But then move over to Bulba. Mike caught in the tree line. He'll have to cut his way out of here. But that does mean he is actually still stuck because KP, they're going to surround him. Mike going to TP out in time. Yes, he does. Liquid very lucky to escape that one. Mike is slightly overextending himself. And Envy saw the opening, threw out the lance, got the slow. But Pylite, I couldn't get close enough to get a proper stun off. So there was no possible chain on the Team Liquid supports.
Yeah, this is one of the things that I was really, really fearing when I saw the Bane pick up the Enfeeble. A lot of times it's really nice, especially in like 3v1 scenario, or even I guess, Lifestealer or Luna, those kind of heroes. You can shut down their CSing in the lane. But first of all, Kaipi is actually playing this lane really, really safe. Like a lot safer than they could, because they can get really aggressive with their heroes. A lot more aggressive than Liquid's. Especially if they have a creep buildup, all they need to do is just make a couple nice maneuvers, and then all of a sudden you have like something like worth like 4 or 5 heroes right clicking. And Tactical Pause number 2 comes out. But once again, if he did not have the Enfeeble, but he had a Nightmare in that engagement, he would have not only secured one guaranteed kill, but there might have been also even a follow up. And yeah, it's just, I don't know, this Enfeeble level 1 in the tri lane, I think it's costing them a little bit more than it should.
Mm-hmm. Looks like Ryze just having a couple of problems, both with ping as well as rage.
This is actually US East, huh?
Yeah, we're on US East. Well, it's Team Liquid playing as well as Eternal Envy on KP.
Right.
No, yeah, I know Envy like has no issue playing with on Luxembourg.
Like, but Liquid.
Yeah, Liquid will still play US East, and US East servers have been very iffy.
Yeah, lately they've been very, very iffy. And of course, they have the couple West Coast players like Fluff and Brian. That's the same people. Fluff and TC. Yeah, they're West Coast players, so I guess it becomes a little bit more difficult. These server things, they actually, in statistics, we see them. In the actual game, spectators won't ever see them. But I read a Reddit post the other day where this guy actually did the calculations, apparently, according to him, he kept the statistics for all the North American teams fighting in... Oh, you know what? There's an engagement, so I'll have to say
well,
that.
Well, maybe. Bane's thinking about it, but it just becomes a D ward at the end of the day. Yep. Unless you're going to take Korok again. He's like, well, okay, if you're lagging, I'm going to make the most out of this one. Just orbs over the top of him, is able to attack, and he's walking around with a regeneration rune, so he's feeling all the confidence in the world just to attack. And you give Korok like confidence, like items to give him confidence... It's a dangerous, dangerous world to be in that mid lane. And then another orb flies out, and Orion's going to get hit by it. If Korok wanted to jaunt on the back of that one...
Mm-hmm. He would have secured the kill. I think it's because he didn't have initial vision of it, so he kind of wasn't prepared. Once again, playing it safe is fine. He's just regened up to the full, and Orion is kind of getting dominated in the lane. But just another to reiterate about the point of the lag. Liquid and Dignitas collectively, which are two top-tier North American teams, were back then, about a couple of weeks ago, 2-2 for 20 on the European servers, and 36 for 17 on the East servers. So statistically, like, if that is actually correct statistics, something really needs to change, because it really tells the tale about the difference of how impactful games are.
And bottom lane, Envy gonna get stunned up. Lifestrike Array, however, returns it over towards Mike. There's no extra burst damage with the Lance flying up and the Slave. Pylite dies, able to get the range to get the kill, but Bulba wants to initiate. Rage is already gone, which means now nice double stun by Fluff and stuff. Zizu as well as Pylite die. They want to keep combining there, and Bulba also wanted to do damage there, but just incapable of doing so. Enfeeble still only at level 1, but it's enough just to really put a hamper on his day.
Yep, the Enfeeble doing a lot of work in shutting down the Lifestealer's damage, but once again, this is just the power of this trialing that KP have. A lot of people actually think PL is really, really weak as a hero early. The only real weak point PL has is just before he gets his second item up. Usually you get a Jangle first, and then between his Jangle, there's either Yasha or Diffusal Blade coming. And that's the only time, which is during like usually the first night, that you can really gank him successfully and change his game plan. Because let's be honest, I mean, his Lance, one of the best early game nukes in the game as a carry hero, his base agility, which is really high, his movement speed, not the best, but you know, you always rush Tranquil, so it's mitigated to an extent. And yeah, there's just so many things going for this hero that normally you don't really aggressive trialing against him with a Rubick. Rubick is more of a safety hero, kind of just mitigates the damage or the engagement, and yeah, it's not working out so far. I mean, yeah, it really is not.
I just love the little bit of a game of cat and mouse that was happening up here on the top lane between TC as well as Bone7. It's been a rather quiet lane as far as us looking at it, and I'm kind of waiting for that bottom lane to erupt, so I'm keeping my right eye over on that one. My left eye looks at this top lane. The Bone7 with 3 points up now in the battery assault. You can see him try and chase down TC, and TC makes sure he always keeps that little bit of extra space between him and the Clockwork Goblin. He doesn't want to get in close at all. But he may have no choice. When Bone7 finally picks up those arcane boots and 300 gold, then there's going to be the mana pool to then throw out your ultimate, have everything else you require for the cogs. And TC's been kept pretty low. Like, he ever comes in close and tries to initiate on Bone7 after he pops off that battery assault, pops off the cogs, TC runs out of his mana because he gets mana burn by coming in range to the cogs, and then he can't lose some beam arise, he can't do anything like that, nor has your TP. TP's up. So they're going to see if they can kill up this top lane.
Surprise rotation, Bone7. TC low on mana has one nuke, but I'm assuming with the movement speed advantage of the Luna, after the nuke as well as the pullback, they'll be able to right-click him down. But I'm actually surprised Bone7 is not getting a bottle. If he gets a bottle and bottle curls efficiently
here
with
you go.
The mid lane.
Bone7 picked up, throwing down. TC's got one Lucent Beam, which he'll throw out right now, and we lost the vision. Now over on the sidelines, they've got Lucent Beam as well as double Fae Bolt. So Lucent Beam thrown out, Fae Bolt, still enough mana even after the burn from the cogs. At the same time, there's a kill on the bottom lane. Whereas Lashrak to go down.
Ah, that's right. I was watching the Lashrak and you said Bone7 picked up, and I was thinking, wait, that's the Lashrak, that's Flo. But then I realized we were watching two different things. Yep, I saw the engagement bottom. Pilot Die landed a very nice stun. They get the kill and it's 1-1 going 2-2 in the nighttime now. But once again, it's just, I know Liquid's theory. If they go even against the PL in the tri-lane versus tri-lane, then what they do is they have a Luna that's going ahead against the Clockwork. Or, you know, that's what was expected anyway, and it is happening in numbers. 39 for 20 Luna versus 16 for 4 Clockwork. She is doing well, especially with that kill just now. But I still worry if Luna alone will be enough to make a game impact necessary. Because at this point in the game, like, looking at this strategy, they're looking to take it late as well. And then it just comes down to the initiations
Are they really thinking about that? Because for me, I feel a lot more mid-game pressure coming out from Team Liquid to a point where KP probably won't have enough to deal with it. If they blow an RP in a wrong position, then all hell could break loose. Bulba, maybe gonna get caught out here. He could have gone to Rage and evaded that, but decides to hold it for the moment. And Arise, now gonna go for the RP. Holds Bulba there. Bane, he's got nothing left apart from right clicks, but the shockwave is there from Magnus. So they pick up Bulba as he's just trying to farm up and eat like a camp over on the side in that bottom lane.
A little bit of an aggressive play from him. Of course, cannot forget the rotation from Ryze, that was very good. And speaking of rotations, Korra's coming in now. Against the PL, he won't be able to do much, and as well as the Bane. Look at that life point. Well, holy moly. What a support hero that is.
Not to mention everything else here, then just steal from you.
Yeah, the movement speed, the steal.
Oh, man.
And that's
big for Korok. We're looking at it just before 9 minutes. Blink Dagger comes up on him already. This is that mid-game pressure I was thinking about. Like, you're talking about KP and Liquid taking a late game up against them. I don't even think they want to do that. Like, Luna's getting, not only is he getting, like, good levels up here on the top, like, good farm up on the top lane, but he's also finding levels. This is going to allow them just to pressure out the towers, and then you got a Nakes bomb initiation that could come on the back of a Puck. Sure, Nakes isn't level 6 because he's been splitting the experience on this bottom lane, but his items, okay, they're also not that fantastic, but if the initiation's going to work, if they get Korok in there, he'll be the main man doing the damage. Bulb will run around the middle of the fight, basically being an absolute nuisance, and then Fluff, he'll throw his stuns, he'll throw whatever else he's got, find a couple of levels from the team fights, and then they can also melt down the towers if Fluff's capable of living through these engagements. And KP, like, what have they got? They've got RP and then some really good stuns, but both Lina as well as Bane, they haven't found these levels, and Lina and Bane, they can shut down, what, one support? They might bring down Rubick, they might bring down the Lashrak, if they use their combo. Like, we saw Fnatic doing it very, very nicely during the Starladder Finals, where it was like the Fiends grip the control, roam around, throw the Laguna Blade, get these kills, and just keep that advantage going your way, so it's always like 5v4 kind of thing. But Liquid won't care about that. Liquid, of course, Korok, we know the way he normally plays, which is basically, protect me at all costs, and I will win us the game. That's what we always remember from Korok.
Yes, that's right. It is his playstyle to just go in there and wreck things. Of course, very well known for it, very good at snowballing in those kind of scenarios. However, once again, I still ask the question, like, even if Korok is able to shut down a couple of the really, really good spells, you have to keep in mind, once again, that KP, they have a lot more room to mistakes. Like, this is KP, this draft coming out of KP is a draft that they can actually literally get team wiped, lose Roshan, and still hold the hill of their base while the PL farms, entirely because their draft is so, like, it's oriented towards turtling and shutting down pushes. It's not the best for pushing. It's good for split pushing, because when PL has items, all he does is push 1v5. But until then, yes, they are playing a defensive game. But I still wonder, can Liquid break the defensive barrier that KP is putting up? And I don't know. And that's why I actually talked to Boba about this the other day also, which is why I say this, the whole going aggressive against the PL, going even, and then expecting the Luna to carry. And you can see it in TC's items too. He's going to go for the Treads, he's going to go for the Dominator. And last time I've seen this, he actually rushes the Butterfly to not fight at all. And to be fair, you know, I got to say, against the Bane, Magnus, and Clockwork, Butterfly might not be the best option. Even Manta might be better. Regardless, I think he's going to go for a semi-damage slash damage item and really transition to the late game. Because we've been theory crafting about what is a hero in the late game that can actually fight a PL and win? There's a couple options. There's Void, who can pretty much 1v1 man fight anyone. PL farms way faster than Void regardless, not to mention he's a lot more useful. There's the Luna, which has lifesteal as well as the ability to actually kill illusions while not losing damage. And there's the Anti-Mage, who can usually keep up or farm better than the PL in the early stages and end up split pushing faster than the PL because the AM gets bigger. They've opted to ban the Anti-Mage, ban the Void, and pick up the Luna. I think their game is fairly clear, and they should realize it too. Like, they should understand that if they do go late, which is what you fear, of course, they will lose. I mean, there's no way. If just like one BKB coming out of like the Magnus, or one good initiation coming out of the Magnus, BKBs or spell disruptors by the Clockwork Bane, silences and stuns, whatever, it'll disrupt Liquid's flow. Because Liquid has this distinct combo that they have to land. You know, you mentioned the Nakes bomb, and that has to go through. You see the Rubick and the Leshrac. You know, KP's supports are on the level, but look at the Rubick and look at the Leshrac. They're at an even worse situation because the majority of the time they were spending in the aggressive tri-lane, which did not really succeed to their most content, idealistic, you know, view on that. And unfortunately, this is going to not spiral well for Liquid. So in the mid game, it really does come down to Korok's play. But I'm still very curious, and I'm honestly, I'm going to give the benefit of the doubt to KP here, if there is the doubt at all, and say, I think they're going to be able to hold the attempts to break their barrier by Korok, and they're going to be able to transition it into the late game with the PL getting too big for Liquid to handle.
See, I'm not quite sure I want to give that advantage, man. I'm going to play devil's advocate right now and say Team Liquid. I still think their pushing power, their engagement, and their abilities they have, it's going to be enough. It's going to be enough to break the base. It will, of course, come down for me to positioning. Massive amounts of positioning, and who will take the advantage in that one. Because if Team Liquid gets the side up, if they know what's going on, then KP will never find their initiation. And it's not like we're going up against things like track, but now that we hit like 9 minutes in, oh, a quick pause from Bol, looks like he's not ready. As the reason for the pause was not DDoS, it's KP who were just changing team speaks. As I'm assuming that our clairvoyance one sucks. Ah, so they had to.
I didn't hear that one.
Yeah.
Sorry, I missed it. What did you say?
Absolutely nothing, because you missed it. So yeah, 3-2. 3-2 on the board. But yeah, I'm looking forward to seeing. I'm looking forward to seeing who gets the positioning and who gets the wars now in the middle lane. It's going to be the death here of Bone 7. Maybe not. The Cog's pushing him back out again. Mike able to do the damage, and Korok has to bottle himself up. Maybe he'll have to... there we go. Blink away. That creep wave was at the possibility of killing him off just then.
Very, very close. Was there any chance Bone 7 could have actually played that better to get the kill? I missed it. But I saw the end of it, and I feel like every time I see a hero that's at like 40 HP or something, who can just die in like one right click, I feel like there was just some possible method to play better and actually secure it. I don't know, just my greed or something.
I came in to see him basically fighting a 2v1 and almost killing off a hero, so I'm not gonna go down on him.
Mm-hmm.
So TC, man, he's doing some decent damage this top tower too. Not massive amount, but considering it's just a solo hero pushing out that lane, it's not too shabby. And Clockwork Goldman's going to come back up here after he was in the middle lane of all places, because Arias was out wandering. But Arias also 10 minutes in. Like, we're looking at him with Bottle, Wand, and Arcane Boots up and running. Look for the timing for his Blink Dagger, obviously well behind the puck, but that's because Korok decided to go a raw Blink Dagger. Normal Boots, Bottle, and Null Talisman, the Null he started off with.
Mm-hmm. Yep, he did indeed rush the Blink Dagger, and it has certainly made its impact now. Once again, let's hope that it pans out to him making even a bigger impact with it. I'm really looking forward to some...
He's going to go on Bulba, and Bulba, well, he got the Rage off in time, so he's not copying a lot of damage from this, but Pylai die, able to get the follow-up stun. There's the Lance, and then follow through with the Slave. It is Eternal Envy to get the last hit out, which means now Tier 1 tower on the bottom lane can take some damage. At the same time, there's three heroes that are grouped up for Team Liquid on the top lane. They're going to fade Bold. Is there going to be a Rift? Yep. They're going to clean up this creep wave and see if they can get a counter tower.
Mm-hmm. It looks like it'll be a tower for tower exchange, just looking at the map as well as the responses. Bulba did die, got picked off alone at the bottom lane, and he's actually returning to the bottom lane. I know he thinks that with the Rage he won't be able to die in this scenario again.
Oh, Arise, middle lane engagement. Use the RP to pick off that Latrak, but still says it's worth it.
Oh, very nice. He actually got the solo kill on the Lesh Trap. Very, very nice.
Just skewed in range of the Tier 1 tower, let off the RP, threw out the shockwave, and Latrak was dead.
Gave him the Magnus Spear.
It's called Dominating Hard by Wooly Magnus.
Wooly Magnus, indeed. Looks like there's a little bit of farming going on by Bulba at the bottom lane. Once again, he's sitting at 0-2, 32 CS at 12 minutes. Not the ideal scenario for him, and it's... From my personal experience, it's not his favorite role, so I really fear for Liquid as to how they're going to transition into this mid-game, because Korok, finally, there is the smoke up. He has the haste rune in the bottle, which is a giant deal, and if they can get a kill as well as the tower here, they'll be in a really, really nice shape. And we'll see how... Oh, Arise has an invis rune, but there's a sentry ward down in the mid lane.
They're prepared for everything, man. Luna will take the tower. Korok's going to come down. I think they caught a quick glimpse of him just then. They're pinging out to the side. And the reason why, Bulba, they found Bane. Bane just stand there, eating damage. Latrak with the summies. There's going to be no TP out of this one. And Korok doing what Korok does best, stealing the last hit from Bulba. And then they'll move themselves down to find Pylai Dai. Puck throws out the ultimate. Open Wiz might still be on cooldown. Pylai Dai's not going to TP out, but again, fluff and stuff. Secondary TP. Second TP being cancelled off by the stun for the second time by Fluff. And it goes 5-5 now with KP getting called out. And Envy just says, I'm bailing from here. And goes all the way back to base. But a very weird position for Zizu to get called out. It looks like he's just standing there, just thinking, like, smelling the flowers or... I don't know.
Yeah, he really was. Like, he was actually just standing there for 2 seconds while a couple of heroes just walked by. And then they reacted, and he was just still, you know, staring at nature. But regardless, Liquid does get what they were looking for. They get the tower, and instead of just getting the tower plus one, which is a casual scenario, they get the tower plus two, and now this is a second tower that's going down their way. I feel like with this kind of advantage...
TP top. Phone 7's here. Korok wants to blink down, but the cog damage actually stops him from instantly going for the blink. Now he's down, and Bulba was brought with him. Nice little hit there with the Clockwork Goblin. Korok actually getting locked in position by Zizu using that Fiend script. And now he can go over to Bulba. Pylai Dai has Laguna Blade too. May as well throw it. That'll be the death of Bulba instantly. Throw it. There she goes. Nightmare instantly after. And then the Slave to ensure the kill. So both Puck as well as Snakes, they might get the plus two on the bottom lane, but what they took a Bane and they took a Lina in return for a Puck and a Nakes. Supposed T1 tower as well, but Envy's up here to make sure they get that counter back.
Yeah, I can imagine what was going on there on their moment when we were doing that. They said, okay, I got hit by the clock with cock, but we're still in. We can catch him for sure because we have the open woods. So let's go.
RP, he does it again. Skewers back Fluff in range of the T1 tower. Fluff is able to get the stun, but the shockwave is there, throws it out, and Magnus gets the kill. So now there's three heroes for KP in the space of 1 minute, and they took the T1 tower on the top lane.
Man, this is like a really lot of bad things going for Liquid. After they took the bottom tower, they could have actually just given up the T1 top, and they should have.
Picked up, thrown down, lose the beam and death. Fable being used, and he had the 3 points in the brain sap, which was stolen by Mike. So he had the double nuke to go the way of the Bane. But he came in very, very deep there, trying to throw down that aggressive ward. And he got it down at the end. But yeah, I don't think he's expecting Team Liquid to have that many people there.
Certainly not. And just once again, I feel like Liquid, after they had the advantage, or even after just that last kill, I feel like they really, really, really need to secure Roshan right now, because as the game is progressing, I mean, Luna's gonna farm. She has her core items up, and she has the treads up. She's gonna farm very fast.
Oh, blink, but middle lane.
Oh, missed.
Just missed by a Ryze. It was only just, though. Like, that line was almost perfect. Fluff was just a little bit of like a hoof to the right.
Well, third time's the charm, Toby. But yeah, it's just the PL's gonna farm, the Luna's gonna farm. Liquid's doing a good job pushing the towers. But what are they going to transition to after they push the towers?
Blink down. It's the initiation again. It's the Nakes Bomb. They bring down the Bane, but now we've lost Infest. We've lost Puck. With his Blink in, a lot of his mana and TC getting slowed down as Arise wants to follow this one up. Missing. Oh, Clockwork Long Latch in from Bone 7. Cox to go down. He pops off the Blade Mail and actually kills the Lunar in return. The double kill is there. Bulba chasing down Bone 7, looking for sweet ass revenge, but it's not going to come. Bulba now shockwaved, lanced up. The Rage is worn off. Puck will throw the ulti. Envy will take the Sun. Laguna Blade from Pylai Dai gets the kill while Korok is bottling up. He can blink right now, and the Lance will fall him over the side, which will then phase shift away. But Arise, he's right behind him. He's got RP available too. Oh, he's just nicklit on the heels of Korok. He can blink in 4 seconds though. But they give it up. They give it up. They're happy with what they managed to claim. And what a blade mail timing.
Yeah, oh my gosh. That is such a big play. That blade mail from Bone 7 actually changed the entire fight. Rarely do you ever see a Clockwork rushing blade mail as the first item. This used to be a very, very common item pick up on Clockwork, but it was
Korok!
Never a first item.
Arise jumped in again. Now he's going to get Fiend's Grip. Arise will hold the RP, skewers down Korok to ensure the kill. But he faked the RP at the start, and I think Bane just made the call and said, you know what, I'll go the Fiend's Grip, and now Fiend's Grip stolen by IXMike88. Wonderful pickup. Wonderful, very nice pickup.
Yeah, you can't stop Fiend's Grip from ever getting take, pretty much. Most of the Bane players, they're usually just not only not focusing on that, but it's just the 5 second channel. And I know he picked it up after, but regardless, I don't think there were many targets that he could have brain sapped. And nightmaring yourself or somebody else to get rid of the Fiend's Grip, probably not something many people think of on the spot. Mm-hmm. Regardless, yeah, the big pickup by Arise, and this is, once again, like the third or fourth time he's actually skewered people back with the Blink Dagger. He's doing it really, really well. And it's actually really hard to get targets that are really expecting it. But what that fight at the top lane, oh my gosh, that blade mail timing, it just, like, the fact that TC ended up killing himself made them win the fight. And TC now, he's got to wonder, like, is he going to transition into the BKB now after
seeing
that?
Yeah, he's already got the Ogre Club. Unless he goes Sanjay Yasuo, which I highly doubt.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, he's going to transition. He has to. And I can't believe how game-changing this is.
Envy's got trouble. The dust's going to pop. They already saw him walk off to the left. And now Mike got to pick him up. They find the right one. He used the Fiend's Grip that was stolen before. Fluff also using probably a little bit too much mana there. Didn't have to throw off both the Pulse as well as the Edict and everything else. But then a lot of support coming in from the side. Bone 7 comes in with an Invis rune, and he finds Fluff. So into the barrage. Fluff will never get a stun off here. Every time he tries to do it, he'll just get stunned off, and Arise comes in with a bit of a shockwave to help him get the kill. And you're talking about Liquid wanting to go for Roshan. Well, they just lost the Lashrak, and they were grouping up to go for it, and instantly KP throw the rocket down. They are searching for exactly the same thing, man. Liquid going into the rock pit.
Yeah, they're very nice pickup on Lashrak, kind of just completely ruled the idea right out of the window. Bone 7, really, really making the impact where it's needed. He's been the pretty much, like, his numbers don't show it, but what can I say? He's been the game changer so far. That Lashrak kill completely preventing Liquid from going for Rosh, because they had the small timing after the PL died, which is why two of their supports TP'd. Unfortunately for Fluff, I think he decided to walk instead, which didn't work out in the end. And of course, now they're gathering into the enemy jungle, trying to look for something aggressive. But I'm guessing that Eternal Envy, from all his PL experience, he's not going to be silly and walk into his own jungle like that. He loves farming the enemy jungle, and now that they have wards up there, he's definitely going to go for that.
I actually want to comment about those wards. I don't know how much time I'll have to do it, though, but this wardy positioning is very, very similar to that of what is done by the old No Tidehunter, by the Alliance. They do exactly this kind of thing, but it's a little bit different, though. Normally, they plan a bit more of an aggressive ward up around here, or up on the high ground to watch the entry into the jungle, and then just leave PL inside the Dire jungle, and always add that pressure. So like Liquid, they group themselves up with five heroes. Man, Clockwork, there's a long latch into TC, who is trying to farm the Aegis. Open Wound is there too. He's holding the Blade Mail now. RP off from Arise. They've got the kill on the Luna. Fiend Script out on Bulba, and what was stolen? Shockwave was stolen, but Bulba is still held in position. Bone throw up in towards the air. That Courier, no, I mean Courier, the Rocket flies out there. The Earth to go down. Mike takes a fall. The fake PL chasing after Bulba, but Fluff as well as Bulba already retreating in the blink to Shockwave. Oh, that was just hopeful for Arise.
Yeah, hopeful for Arise indeed, but landing a fairly decent RP in that scenario. Nothing was there to stop the Fiend Grip because the Split Earth went down, and Zizzle did a very smart thing in picking that up and actually Fiend's gripping. KP is in a huge advantage right now. It might not show in the numbers. I'm checking the graphs right now. They've only got 5k EXP, but only 1k gold, and that's probably because TC is so farmed. But really, this is just one of those scenarios where the gold and the numbers are not telling the tale. When you're going even against a PL like this versus a Magnus and a Bane and Clockwork, who are heroes that, even if you have a BKB, are gonna still disable you and lock you down against the highest damage output carry in the game, which is PL, it's not going to spell well for you. And this is exactly the scenario what I was fearing about. Because look at Liquid now. What does this Lifestealer, he's 0 and 4, 47 CS, he has a Jangle and Phase Boost. Like, what is this guy going to do in the teamfight? He's not going to do anything in the teamfight. He's going to tank one spell and he's going to die. As for all the other members of Liquid, they're going to die too, except Korok, because not only do they have no farm, but they have no levels, no escape, and more importantly, they're just going to get caught in the bigger AoE spells coming out of KP. So it's not spelling that well for Liquid right now. It just really is not.
They have to fall back. There's the Infest now. Bulba already feeling very low on life. Nice latch up again by Bone7. He holds Fluff out of position while the puck holding from Korok is nicely positioned, but his teammates just don't have enough life points. Maybe Bulba does. Attempt RP. He decided to hold it at the end of the day because they don't need it. Everyone's gone by Korok, who's a little bit further down. And now spotted, Courier's in there, he jumps and he's trying to snipe off Roshan, jumps up and avoids the Light Strike Array. Maybe going to jump back in again, bottling up a little bit more, Pilot Eyes chasing him. And there's your RP, hold him, follow up stun, and that's Team Liquid, fully wiped.
Fully wiped, as Rosh is at 1k HP.
Now Bone 7! He gets stunned by Roshan. I thought maybe Roshan would go for a secondary swing and try and bring him down, but... Like Roshan.
Dire Tide all over again. Man, those were the days.
Give me your candy.
Yeah, pretty much.
Again, we want to start the whole thing. Valve, give us custom maps. Give us custom maps that we can create ourselves as well. Just after we did the LGD show match with everyone doing Pudge solo mid. You know, it's going to happen. We need Pudge Wars. We need all this kind of stuff to come our way. And then everybody will play Dota, as opposed to just everybody who's cool right now.
Oh, That's a little bit of a statement that you make, but speaking of cool people, Liquid must not be feeling cool right now. 20-9 against the Roshan, level 2 Diffusal PL, 3-1-8. they don't have the heroes to deal with this. And once again, this is why I said no to this strategy just from the start. It's not going to work. Like, this is one of those things that you have to be significantly better and just completely outplay the opponent to the point where the draft would not even matter. But you have to consider the draft. You have to look at the opponent players that you're dealing with. And you have to consider all these factors that you normally would not consider in a real match. When it came down to it, KP played better. And as a matter of fact, they not only played better, but they also punished the slight mistakes that Liquid gave every single way. And look at the score now. Even though Liquid was able to get those early kills in the mid lane as well as the bottom lane, they threw it away completely just by a couple snipe pickoffs and that gigantic fight at the top lane with the Bone 7 popping up his blade mail and just killing the Luna. It's not going to spell well. I'm not too sure what their options are right now. They can turtle with the Luna at best, but eventually your heal's going to be broken by a PL split pushing, as well as the Magnus and the Bane, as well as the Clockwork. And all these support heroes, they're going to continue to have impact. As for Liquid support heroes, they have cast animations, they're squishy liabilities
four
against
stuff.
PL. And
there goes Korok. Skewer him down just to make sure he stays stunned. Also brings him in range for a brain sap. But Mag will take his life, but he four-starred himself in closer, so then he could actually blink up and get the RP. And now is a 4v5, and now clock long latch. Envy's already here, coming up inside of his own Invis. So two heroes lost, and that wasn't even with an aggressive ward. That was just because PL was inside their jungle.
Mm-hmm. Yep, it's... I don't know. I hate to say it this way, but I think Liquid lost this game from the start, and... I really feel bad that they actually gone with a strategy that even though they were prepared with and they played against the PL who they've lost to, Eternal Envy. I mean, KP Liquid, last time they played together, Liquid did win 2-0. But just before, KP was able to stomp them in a very convincing fashion, 1-0. Mm-hmm. And they're doing it again. This is looking very similar to the first time these two teams faced off as ever since Eternal Envy's joined the team. And I feel like they should have been better prepared for this.
Well, it is a best of one man preparation. So keep it that, because if you don't do it, you lose one game and you're out. That's the way the Masters works. You've got to win every single time until you get to the grand final, and then you get yourself a best of three matchup. Everything
which
else
is
best of one, including the semifinals.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And which is why, of course, the Magnus is so good, because, you know, one big matchup and, of course, one big RP solves most of the time that equation. Looks and like, KP's got it.
Looks like Liquid want to get on the front lines. They're holding themselves back apart from the PL, who's, as you were saying, like split pushing. He goes down the bottom lane now to head inside his own jungle. But Liquid are here with smoke. They're waiting for somebody from KP to come to them. And the timing is just too long. Now they got to go. Rocket flies off. TC might get revealed. Does get revealed. So there's the real Eternal Envy. Dustwall pops. They can see him properly. And now Bulba just jumps off RP. It holds IX Mike 88. Then skewers him in. And then everyone's grouped up together. But Mike picks him up. Throws him down. They get a little extra stun here. So the full Eclipse can come off. Pylon dies hitting his own BKB. But he will take a fall. It's actually a 2-for-2 right now. Korok will go down. So Eternal Envy comes out of his Aegis of the Immortal. And TC, Diffuser Blade up. Envy will now focus him down. Fluff gets a nice stun, but he's the only one surviving, and that is now over as well. Whole team from Liquid being wiped. They pop through two heroes in an Aegis of the Immortal.
Mm-hmm. Full team wipe against the PL. I don't see a comeback happening at all. PL's got 3.9k in his bank. He's about to pick up Mantis out. There it is. GG.
Fluff will admit the defeat, so KP, they will take the first game here in the joint out of Masters and will advance themselves through into the semi-final of the JD Masters. If you want to check out the details, head yourself over to joinnota.com and go to the Masters page. You can find it in the Tournaments tab. And you'll see the matchup that is there. So KP went up against Liquid. They'll face up against the winner of EG versus Mouse. EG versus Mouse being the last game of the night. They'll be starting up at 21:30 CEST. And then we'll be jumping into our next game, which is QPad. The QPad Red Pandas will be going up against Na'Vi. That'll be the next game. Fnatic versus RoxKiss will then follow that one. And that'll be all your four best of one matches for the joint out of Masters. And then we return tomorrow evening. And that'll be around 18 CEST. And we'll be starting off with the semifinals, both semifinals, and then the best of three grand final coming your way. This is the way the Masters functions. You're going to be masterful during all your games. And, well, Team Liquid, they didn't really find that mastery here in game number one.
Unfortunately, they did not, and let's hope they do in their next matchup, which I can't see because I can't tab out.
Yeah, well, their next game, well, check out the details. I believe they're actually playing Premier League in about 28 minutes' time up against Alliance. So if you want to watch that, you can do so. If you want to stay on the best live stream out there right now, then you are in the right place. It is Topi1Dota's live stream for JoinDota.com. We're doing the AMD Join Dota Masters. If you haven't already put yourself into the running to win those free copies of Bioshocks, as well as the possibility of winning those wonderful cards coming out, then yeah, definitely head yourself over to the article, and that's over on joindota.com, and you can win courtesy of XFX Radeon, the 7790HD graphics cards. You can find them there. All you gotta do is basically follow the instructions there, or you can join up at the Join Dota Open. So many options, so many free shit. It's gonna be great, it's gonna be fantastic. We'll be back here as well, guys. We'll be back here as well in a couple of moments' time. Na'Vi, their game is up now. QPad Red Pandas, we'll see if they have a little bit more success than they had earlier today. You'll find out. Stick around.